Welcome to Show and Tell with the Two Mortgage Guys. We come to you live on Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and LinkedIn every Tuesday at noon. Today, Ryan and I are going to be talking about down payment assistance and what it can do for you. Stick around.
Hey,
we are here and ready to go. So got some exciting stuff to sort of talk about. Money, right?
Money. It's always fun talking about money, especially free money.
That's right. When you can get it. But there's sometimes a hitch with free money that you got to look into. And that's sort of what we're going to try to help explain to everybody today. Give them a little bit of information on some down payment assistance programs that we've got available. There's some of them that are one of them we're going to talk about. It's available, I think, in most states. So there's just different things around it. Trying to give people a little bit of insight on contacting us just to try to help see if there's an avenue for them.
And let's lead with the fact that, you know what, we're not advocates for down payment assistance for everybody. There's some pros and cons. We're going to talk about that in today's show. But there are people and scenarios where it could be the difference in them getting into a home. So we're going to kind of show you what's out there available to you, how it would work, who qualifies, you know, the whole process, right? So let's get into that.
Yeah, let's look at it. So a couple things on down payment assistance. You know, it's like Ryan said, it's not just free money. It's out there for anybody that wants to get it. There was at one time, and we will live through that back in, I think it was 2009 or 2010, when Obama was in, that there was actually some grants. Now, again, I think one of them was no strings attached, but the other, and you had to live in the house for 3 years. So there was, it seemed like that there was always something that sort of tied you a little bit to the property.
Yeah, there's definitely a hitch. In fact, these programs we're going to share today, both of them have basically periods of time you have to be committed to living in the home, you know, and in some cases even unable to refinance the mortgage. And, you know, and if you do, it's not the end of the world. You're just going to owe that money back, basically that free money that you're getting to use for your down payment. You'll owe it back in the event you were to sell the home or refinance it. So, Steve, tell me when I need to be fast forwarding these slides too, because I know you built this sucker out. But
okay,
let's start with Indiana Housing, because this is probably going to be the preferred program between the two in most cases. Indiana Housing Development, there's credit requirements, 640. Kind of lowest case scenario, 680. If you have 680, you basically get the flexibility to borrow a little bit more, basically have a higher debt to income.
Right. And that's the big piece on that, right? Is this when, is the flexibility, not just maybe in the down payment assistance, but like in loan programs in general, right? Like, for USDA, if it happens to be 660 or above, you, it's a little bit easier to get the loan than if you're 640 or below. Although it's close, right?
Yeah. And the thing about credit scores too, you got to understand as a consumer, you know, there's three major credit bureaus, and in the mortgage industry, we're looking at what's called your mid score. So your TransUnion, your Equifax, Experian, we're going to take the middle one, not the best, not the worst. That middle score is what kind of determines a lot of the eligibility for different programs. Same thing with the down payment assistance. So in addition to having to qualify for the down payment assistance, you have to meet the program, the loan program requirements as well, right? And they're going to be this or lower.
Right. Yeah, exactly on that side. And that's like it said in there, the credit score minimums. And again, we like to use that word, the minimum. That's sort of like the least part. We really like to get it higher than that if we can.
Yeah.
But it's like Ryan said earlier, there's pieces of it. That's one piece. So it's, there's money available if you've got a credit score, and then going into that next slide's the other part's that income, right? So you got credit, and then you got to be able to have income that meets those guidelines.
And what they're concerned with is that, you know, you have enough income to make the payments, that you meet the debt to income requirements, that you can afford it, but it's not for everybody. There's also a maximum income. You know, if you make too much money, then they're not going to offer this down payment assistance to you. And the crazy thing is, we just experienced, or literally last week, is there the income requirements that they're going to look at to determine if you make too much, is different than the income calculations they're going to look at to determine if you can handle the payment. That's something that we're going to guide you through. We're going to help figure that out up front.
Right. Because like you said, it is different, right? So you can make possibly too much money, but still need some assistance on it. And then that's where another one we'll talk about in a little bit goes into it. But like on this one right here, just if that's where you're at with the family sizes of, you know, families 1 to 2 or 3 or more, for us, and it's like that with most counties, but there's different ones that have different income limits. So again, like Ryan said, you just got to get a hold of us and let us ask some questions. We've got a form we'll fill out, and then we'll be able to get an idea of about where you're at and if you qualify or not.
And this is individual, right? So this is not household. This isn't everybody in the house. This is the amount of people on the mortgage itself, which is a little different than some other programs.
And then that shows, so that other slide had the regular income, then it had census tract income with what it had on it. So most counties and some counties, actually the whole entire thing is underneath a designated census tract. So Howard County's not, or Kokomo basically on it, but as you can see in that map that it runs up sort of 931 and down Markland. In that chunk, part of the downtown, a little bit up in that north inside, up around Phillips Street, maybe something in there. So again, as you look for a house, if maybe in that example, you know, your income needs to be a little bit higher because of the census tract, then if you find a house in there, then you could qualify for one in that area.
And just so we're clear, this is not areas that are eligible for the program. You can use this down payment anywhere. If you're buying a home in these areas, the income limits are a little different. They're cutting you some slack, basically, if you buy in certain areas.
Right. So that goes. And then you get into like the types of the loans that they have for Indiana Housing. And there's a few, but these are probably, what do you say, the most popular, right? First Place is one of them that's out there for everybody in the next home. So First Place is designated for like first time home buyers. Next Home is for, you can use it if you're not a first time home buyer. Which is neat, right? Because life happens, as we know, and sometimes you just don't have enough money. You might need a little bit of help, and that's where that Next Home comes into play at. So talk a little bit about that, Ryan, on those differences.
The biggest difference is if you're a first-time home buyer, you can get up to 6% of the sales price. That 6% down payment assistance, that money can be used to pay for a 3% conventional down payment or a 3.5% FHA down payment. 5% conventional. You can use the leftover portion that's not going to down payment. You can use that to cover closing costs. And you can combine that with some seller credits to kind of make up the difference. So in theory, if this down payment assistance program works for you, you could get enough money between this and seller credits to cover everything. The thing about First Place, look down here, you've got a 9-year forgiveness period. And this is what you need to understand. If you're taking this money, you've got to go 9 years living in that house before to not have to owe it back. Okay. So if you live there for 9 years or longer, that second mortgage, which is what this is, there's no payment that has to be made. It'll just basically go away. If you buy a home with down payment assistance, you live in it for 5 years, decide you want to sell it, you need something bigger, you need to move out of town, whatever, then that balance, that down payment that you took, that 6%, is going to be tacked onto your first mortgage balance. You'll have to pay it back when you sell the house.
Which typically, if in normal markets, homes values increase over a period of time anyway. So if everything goes right over a course of, you know, 5 years or something, 6 years, maybe that piece, now you've built an equity. So if you needed to sell it, you're really not going to be upside down. But hey, life happens. And we've been in this business for over 20 years and we've seen 60%, you know, foreclosures in Howard County. So things can't happen. You just always want to be prepared. And that's one of the things that Ryan and I are always going to try to do is figure out which option's actually better for you. Is it to go with that possibly that you're locked into it, or is it something else that you got on it? Hey, one other piece on that, when you're locked in on that, with that 9 year, it's like, it's that same thing. So if rates are 7%, right, to try to refinance that, if they drop to 6 in 2 years, that's where you're going to run into some issues maybe.
Because remember, it's not just selling the home in 9 years, it's paying the mortgage off, and that includes the refinance. So in my opinion, one of the big downside of the down payment assistance is for 9 years, you're basically telling yourself that you're not going to sell, you're not going to refinance in 9 years, which means you could miss out on some refinance opportunities to save some money if the rates do dip. You're going to have to live in the home longer than you maybe want to or need to 5 years, 6 years from now. And then the other thing that this doesn't show is this program is being used with a conventional or FHA loan. And when we go to lock that loan, the interest rate and closing costs will be a little bit higher on that than they would if you came to us and you had your own down payment. Okay.
Right.
So if you came to us and you wanted to do an FHA loan or conventional, we're going to be able to offer a little bit better terms than we can if we're coupling that with the down payment assistance.
Exactly. And then what we've found on it, which that's still that option, right? But then on the other part that we've also found is that next home. This is the one that we feel like is just a little bit easier to use, I guess, because most people, when they're going to buy a house, at least have a little bit of money saved back. But with, like Ryan said, closing costs and stuff, that's where this can come into hand instead of having the seller possibly help assist and pay some type of closing cost or prepaid items. If they're not willing to do that, that's where this comes into place, to where you can say like, okay, I can do the grant for the additional money I need to get moved into a house.
In essence, the main difference is you're getting 2.5% or 3.5% instead of 6%. However, if you notice down here, the 3-year forgiveness period, you don't have to stay in it as long. So that is the nice attractive part of this program, is you're only obligated to stay in it for 3 years, which much more reasonable amount of time, you know, to sit in a property or not be able to, you know, refinance.
Right. And then this goes into the next one. So Ryan, I'm gonna let you sort of hit with this Chenoa funds, and maybe give a little bit of story about how we sort of came into this.
Yeah. So Chenoa funds has actually been around a long time. And like Steve and I both thought this was like something reserved for, we thought it was like tribal Indian money.
Right.
didn't know until we really started digging into this. Chenoa is just another form of down payment funds. But they look at things a little differently. So while there's no maximum income, the one big thing in here that could keep people from qualifying is what's called payment shock. So let's say you're paying $500 a month in rent, and your new mortgage payment is going to be $800. That's more than 125% increase in your housing expense. And now it won't work. It won't work unless your DTI is at a certain point. So there's caps, basically. Okay. So there's additional caps in here with payment shock. Once again, though, something we figure out for you. We don't expect you to know this stuff. We're going to tell you what works, right? But basically the difference in qualifying is right there. And then on the next slide, Steve, do you have the amount
for
how much you're getting?
No, not on that. With the slides that I pulled from Chenoa when I put that together with it. So, but it goes back in that same thing. Like Ryan was saying, when you, so there's the payment shock, there's different things in that. It's the same thing. We run into this with other loan programs. FHA actually has a payment shock. It's just not brought up a whole lot because most borrowers never even get close to it, but it can at a certain point, like Ryan said, if you've got a debt ratio issue or something. But then there's typically going to be what they'll call compensating factors sometimes that can help override that. So maybe if, like you said, if it's your payment shock, but your debt ratio is lower, you're okay or something like that. Is that correct?
Yep. Yeah. And what I was looking for on that last slide is the amount. So with Chenoa funds, you can get a 5% down payment assistance. And then there's also smaller amounts. And just like the Indiana housing, there's different terms, whether you choose to have it forgivable or if you just want to defer it. So with Chenoa, you can actually say, hey, I'll take the money and I will pay it off, but not for 3 years or 5 years. So there's kind of payback options on that. Something else we can kind of help talk to you guys, you know, about when we get you pre-approved, see what's going to make sense for you, what's going to be feasible and what your best option is.
Right. Because if you do pay it, it's the same thing. As like Ryan said, you get that money, you have to stay in it. If you pay it off, then you basically paid it off. If you want to go do something at a later date, you can do it. You're not tied back to that grant. Or trying to get a subordination, what's called in our industry, when there's a second mortgage tied to a first one to do a refinance. So,
yep. Similar credit requirements, you know, it's not going to be for everybody, but we're going to help kind of figure out if it's for you or not. So look, down payment assistance, it's a real thing. We can offer it. You know, it's not going to be the thing we lead with. it's going to be an option for you. You're always going to be better off, in our opinions, to save the money yourself. You know, if you can have your own down payment saved up and some closing costs, it's just going to allow us to offer you a little bit better options as far as the loan programs go. But if you're just not in a position to do that, but you know you can afford a house payment if you own it, this could work out for you.
Exactly. So that's that same piece, is that we've been able to use this with people that are, they're close, right? Their credit's in good shape. They got their debt ratio. They've been saving money, but hey, life happens to all of us. And whether they're renting or whatever, it just sometimes pinches you and you might just need a little bit extra there. And that's where this is really, really handy to be able to give somebody an avenue to get them into home ownership. So that's something that we always try to look at. But like Ryan said before, this isn't the only piece. This is just one piece of the puzzle. Like Ryan said, if you can save, it's better. Upcoming in one of our series, we'll go over some basic budgeting stuff to try to help people at that same point, because that's where it all boils down to, being able to have that money put aside each month for mortgage, utilities, maintenance as we go through with it.
If you think this might be an option for you, reach out to us. We've got contact information down below. You can call us. You can message us on any of these platforms you might be watching us on now. You can go to our website and do a loan application. Our goal is to show you what your options are, whether that's being able to buy a house today using a program like this, or helping you put together a game plan so that you can buy a home someday. We're going to do everything we can to help you out.
Right. It could be second, third investment properties, anything we can help with it. There's just avenues, and this is just another tool in our tool belt to help people out there with it. So that's it. So good. Hey, thanks. We appreciate it. If you guys have questions, just let us know. I'm going to throw in a big little tidbit on it. So next week's show, we're postponing. We're not going to have one next week, but then we'll follow back up that following Tuesday. So just stay tuned on that, and we'll be back in with some more guests for you. Thanks.
All right. See you guys.
Bye.